Hi, I'm Lisa Hannah, and welcome to another episode of Psychology Matters TV. And today we have with us Sarah Karpie to discuss mental health first aid. So thank you for being here with us, Sarah. And how did you get started with this organization?
Well, thanks for having me. And I got started with mental health first aid in Rochester, New York, where I lived previously before moving to the Nashville area. Mental health first aid is a course that you can take to become a mental health first aider. And similar to CPR, you learn how to respond in a crisis. CPR is a course that you would take to learn how to respond in a physical crisis. Mm-hmm. If someone's heart stops, you would give compressions, and you would do that until emergency care arrives. Mm-hmm. Well, with mental health first aid, you would learn how to recognize signs and symptoms of a mental health crisis or a substance use crisis, and you would help until professional help is available or until the crisis is averted. Mm-hmm. And so it's an 8-hour course that you could take, similar to a CPR course, and you would become certified for 3 years.
Oh, okay. So how did this organization get started?
Well, in Australia, the course was started by a nurse and a health educator who felt like there was a need for this, that people really didn't know how to respond in a mental health crisis. Mm-hmm. People didn't know what to say or what to do or how to get people help. And so the course was started in 2001, and the National Council for Behavioral Health and the Missouri Department of Mental Health brought the course to the United States. Mm-hmm. And okay. Since then, over 12,000 instructors in the United States have been trained.
Wow.
And they have trained over 1 million mental health first aiders.
Okay. Wow.
So it's amazing.
So what are some of the statistics around mental health issues? Is it 1 in 5?
Oh yes, absolutely. So we know that mental health problems are common, mm-hmm. and that's one of the reasons why we encourage people to take this course, because, you know, it could be your family member or one of your friends who's experienced a mental health problem. We know that 1 in 5 people might experience a mental health problem or a substance use problem in any given year. Mm-hmm. And up to 50% of people may experience a mental health problem in their lifetime. Mm-hmm. So mental health problems are really common. Mm-hmm. And people don't often know what to say. You know, if somebody has a sore throat or if somebody gets an operation, we take over a casserole, we know what to do. Mm-hmm. We offer practical help then. But if somebody has a diagnosis of schizophrenia or depression or bipolar disorder, we're often afraid what to say. We are not sure what we should do or how we can be helpful. And this is a course that gives us some practical advice. We know what to do. We learn steps of what we can say. Mm-hmm. So it's it can be very helpful. We learn helpful tips, what we should do. You know, I liken it to the cancer diagnosis of old. You know, we used to whisper, oh, that person has cancer, mm-hmm. because we were afraid, you know, the mm-hmm. prognosis was not very good. And it shouldn't be that way with mental mm-hmm. health problems. You know, we should help decrease the stigma. It
exactly.
used to, you know, we really should be able to say to somebody, gosh, you know, I hear something's going on with you. I really care about you. Let me bring over some supper tonight, or mm-hmm. let me help you get the kids to soccer practice. Offer mm-hmm. some practical help. Mm-hmm. You know, and another thing that the course really helps you with is understanding mental health problems. Mm-hmm. I think people are really afraid because they don't understand what a mental health diagnosis means or what a substance use diagnosis means. You know, if someone has an opioid addiction, people don't understand what that means. And so once you learn a little bit more about it, I think you're not as afraid to approach somebody and say, how can I be of help? Let me do something to help you, or let me help you get connected with the care that you need.
Mm-hmm. And so I assume the course also helps to recognize some of the symptoms and assess that before it gets too far gone?
Absolutely. You know, one thing that you do is you learn a little bit more about each of the mental health problems. You might learn a little bit more about psychosis, a little bit more about schizophrenia, some of the things that people are really afraid of and don't really understand. You learn a little bit more about anxiety and mm-hmm. panic attacks and how to assist someone who might be experiencing a panic attack. One of the things that I like to say is we're not going to give you a cape. You know, when you mm-hmm. take a CPR class, you're not going to learn how to do open heart surgery.
Right.
You're going to learn how to assist. You're going to
yes.
learn how to give compressions until the ambulance comes. Mm-hmm. You're going to learn how to maybe put pressure on a wound until you can get that person to the emergency room. With the mental health first aid class, you're going to learn some skills on how to approach somebody and say, I really care about you and I'm concerned mm-hmm. because here are some of the things that I've observed and I've noticed, and this is why I've become concerned, and I'd really like to see you get some help. You know, this mental health first aid course is not going to help you diagnose and treat mm-hmm. somebody. Just like when you take a CPR class, you're not going to be able to operate, and so
right.
we're not going to be able to become a diagnostician. Mm-hmm. But we're going to get that spidey sense that, hey, something's not right, and mm-hmm. I've noticed that you've lost your ability to live, love, laugh, and learn like mm-hmm. you used to, and
mm-hmm.
I'd really like to see you get some help. And
mm-hmm.
so you just kind of come at it from the kind, caring approach of a loved one or a neighbor or sometimes a stranger at the mall.
Mm-hmm.
If you see somebody having a panic attack, you might learn some steps to help.
Absolutely, in a compassionate, non-judgmental way.
Absolutely,
mm-hmm.
absolutely. So when you take that course in mental health first aid, it is an 8-hour, all day long
mm-hmm.
course. So usually we plan on 9 hours for the course for the day. And that includes lunch and breaks. And you will learn a 5-step action plan. And that 5-step action plan will help you learn how to assess for suicide or risk of harm.
Mm-hmm.
And so you will be learning how to ask the question, are you thinking of killing yourself?
Mm-hmm.
If someone's experiencing extreme depression or has experienced trauma, or is having severe anxiety and panic attacks, they're at risk
mm-hmm.
for suicide or harm.
Mm-hmm.
We know that 84% of people who have taken their life have had symptoms of some sort of mental health problem.
Mm.
We know that 33% of them have alcohol in their system.
Mm-hmm.
And so we want to be sure that we're asking that question if we have any suspicion that someone is suicidal. I think a lot of people are afraid to
mm-hmm.
ask the question.
Yes. It's a hard question.
Yeah,
yes,
you know, they think if they ask the question, they're putting the idea in someone's head, and
mm-hmm.
we really know that's not true.
Mm-hmm.
Very often somebody's so happy to share their story
okay.
and is, you know, happy that somebody cares enough to ask, because
yes.
very often when somebody has suicidal ideation, they think no one cares.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you ask that question, very often you may be the person who saves that
mm-hmm.
one's life. So asking the question is very important, and you may even have to ask the question more than once.
Mm-hmm.
And so being aware of what some of the signs and symptoms of someone who may be feeling suicidal is something that we cover in the course, and then you'll know how to ask the question, and we practice that in this course.
Mm-hmm.
The next step is to listen non-judgmentally. And listening non-judgmentally is so important.
Yes, indeed.
It is. And,
yes.
you know, I think that giving somebody your undivided attention is often the most lovely gift
mm-hmm.
you can give.
Yes.
And, you know, making sure that you do that without dread or without judgment or, you know, putting any guilt on that person, just
mm-hmm.
listening in a kind, caring way is very often the nicest thing that you can do.
Mm-hmm, indeed.
The other thing that we do is we teach you how to give reassurance and information. Giving reassurance and information is so important because we want you to make sure that the person has hope for recovery. It's so important
mm-hmm.
that they have a sense that recovery is possible. You know, very often they have a sense of loss and a sense that, you know, there's no chance that they're ever going to feel better.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you enter in this relationship with somebody that you're trying to help them, you need to give them hope that they can live successfully with early treatment and diagnosis. So you noticing signs and symptoms early helps connect them with the care they so need. Mm-hmm. We know very often that people don't seek treatment for mm-hmm. years and years, very often as long as 10 years. So we want them to get early diagnosis, so giving them that hope for treatment and recovery, early diagnosis is so important, and letting them know they're not alone is really important.
Certainly, yes, yeah. Indeed. And are there resources after assessing someone and deciding that there is a need for treatment? What would be the next step, or what resources are available out there?
Yeah, so the next steps, you know, are to encourage appropriate professional help. And, you know, we want to try to, you know, give that, you know, encouragement for them to seek out the professional help that they need, you mm-hmm. know. Professional help isn't always available. Sometimes it may be you, as the mental health first aider, given that kind, caring mm-hmm. Connection. But you do want to encourage them to seek help from their primary care physician, from a psychologist or psychiatrist, mm-hmm. from a licensed mental health counselor. There are a lot of faith-based groups that can okay. offer help. Mm-hmm. There's self-help groups, there's AA, there's NA, there's Alateen, Al-Anon, there's lots of groups that are available. So there's plenty of opportunities for people to seek the treatment that they need. And then the last one is for them to, you want to encourage them to engage in self-help and other support strategies. Mm-hmm. There's so many things that we can do to take care of ourselves, eating well, getting plenty of sleep, mm-hmm. getting exercise. We cannot underestimate the yes. value of exercise, you know, in our mental health. You mm-hmm. know, we really want to try to make sure that we're taking good care of our bodies and mm-hmm. getting plenty of rest. You know, mm-hmm. sleep is so important too. If we're not getting enough rest, then we don't feel well yes. Physically and mm-hmm. mentally. We can learn to meditate, mm-hmm. do yoga.
Yes.
There are a lot of practices of spirituality that can be helpful to us with our mental health. There's so mm-hmm. many things that we can do. One thing I did want to mention is that when you attend the course, you do receive a manual, and this manual is mm-hmm. full of lots of self-help strategies and and lots of websites that are helpful too.
Okay.
Now the websites have been screened, and that's so important. A lot of times when you go out on the web and you look up things, you're not sure if you're looking at a legitimate site or
right.
something that has mm-hmm. been, you know, screened. And we know that the National Council for Mental Health has really screened these websites that they're recommending, and we know that these are all very helpful. And so you'll receive this manual, which is full of information on mental health problems, eating disorders, and substance use issues, and you can learn a lot about it and how to handle each of those problems should you encounter them in a loved one or someone you care about.
So what are some of the classes that are involved in the mental health first aid?
So mental health first aid, when it first came to the United States, was offered in an adult course. And the adult course is taught to adults who care about intervening when an adult is experiencing a mental health crisis or substance use crisis. And then shortly after that, in 2008, about 2010, they developed a youth course. And the youth course was developed for adults who want to respond to youth who are experiencing mm-hmm. a mental health crisis. I think a lot of people think that the youth course means we teach it to young people.
Mm-hmm, okay.
And we will sometimes offer a youth course to high school students who are in leadership roles, but mm-hmm. for the most part, we're really offering that to teachers or to okay. people who are youth ministers or mm-hmm. Other kind, caring people who really want to respond to youth
certainly.
Who are in crisis. Mm-hmm. So we work on scenarios in that course that really help us specifically deal with problems of young people.
Okay.
And then the adult course has expanded a lot. There's a lot of different modules for
okay.
the adult course. And I think that's one thing that's really exciting that's going on with mental health first aid right now. We have an adult course that focuses on the public safety officers.
Mm-hmm.
So for police officers and emergency responders, firefighters, and that's a really exciting course. So we help them to be able to recognize when somebody is experiencing a mental health crisis, and when they're responding to a public safety call, they know how to de-escalate a situation. And it's particularly designed for people who are in public safety. And so the scenarios are designed specifically for somebody who's working in public safety, which I think is really nice that they've tailored it that way. We also offer a course for veterans and military members and families of military members. You know, particularly focuses on post-traumatic stress disorder and anxiety and depression surrounding that. And, you know, a lot of military families are dealing with different different types of mental health problems and, and different issues than the general public. So we really want to focus on that for them and tailor it specifically for families who are going through problems with things that surround issues with the military. So I think that course is really exciting and one that they've recently released, and I think it's gone over very well. And there's also a new course that's about to be released that is related to industry. And so it helps people who are working in factories and in the workplace to be able to recognize signs and symptoms of anxiety and depression and substance use in the industry. And so that course is going to be released fairly soon. I think that's really exciting.
That is exciting, yes.
And then another course that I really want to spend a few minutes talking about is our higher education course. And I've taught this a good bit. This course is taught at the college level to college students, and we do this a lot of times for dorm leaders and for residence assistants, resident assistants, so that they can recognize when there's a developing substance use problem or a mental health problem among college students. We know that 75% of mental health problems and substance use problems will develop by age 25. And so the college population in particularly is one we really want to focus on and make sure that people who are spending a lot of time with that age group can recognize signs and symptoms and help them get to the college counseling center and get the help that they need. And so that course really does work on scenarios and help college students, you know, see and help each other out and be able to make referrals. And it's really been a popular program and one that's very helpful, particularly with resident assistants, training them and you know, helping to reduce the stigma on college campuses, because you shouldn't be embarrassed to go to the health center to get help or go to the counseling center to get help for a mental health problem, or if you're depressed or having some anxiety around school or something else is going on in your family, or if you're experiencing some problems with substances. It really is important to get the help that you need, and we want to encourage people to do that. So there's quite a variety of courses that are available. And so,
I was thinking with the college population, certainly you mentioned the RAs, and they are there living in the dorms with, you know, and with their colleagues, basically, with their friends. And so they are have a first bird's eye view of what's going on a lot of the time.
Absolutely.
So I'm really excited about that course as well. And plus the anxiety around just being in college and away from home, and there's so many, such a vulnerable age as well. So that's really exciting about that course. So how might someone sign up that wants to take the classes?
So I'm really glad you asked that. If someone would like to take a course in mental health first aid, they just need to go to mentalhealthfirstaid.org, which is the National Council on Behavioral Health's website. And you can just search for a course. It has a tab that says take a course, and you can put in your zip code and find a course near you. I've just started a website in our area called Greater Nashville Mental Health First Aid.
Thank you, yes.
And so you can follow us on Facebook. And so that's a Facebook link. So just, you know, search for Greater Nashville Mental Health First Aid on Facebook and follow us. And anytime that I'm or some of the people that I know are teaching a course, I always post it there so that you can find courses in our area There are lots of people in the Nashville area who are teaching mental health first aid. Mm-hmm. There are about 200 mental health first aid instructors in the state of Tennessee.
Oh, wow.
And so you should be able to find a course near you.
Mm-hmm.
The cost for the course can range anywhere from free, if it's grant supported,
okay,
to $150 a person.
Mm-hmm.
Again, it's an 8-hour course.
Mm-hmm.
It usually takes about 9 hours to complete the course with your breaks and your lunch. Sometimes you take it over a 2-day period. Most of the time you do it in a 1 9-hour day.
Okay.
Which
like
can
on
be,
a weekend,
yeah,
maybe?
Yeah, like on a weekend, or you can mm-hmm. do it during the week. It just depends on
okay.
how the instructor has it set up. And you can receive continuing education units for that
okay,
if you're
that's
a nurse
good.
Or a social worker or a teacher. It depends on how the instructor has it set up. You need to
mm-hmm.
check with your instructor. A lot of times you can find the courses on Eventbrite. If you search on Eventbrite
wow.
for mental health first aid,
okay.
You can very often see courses listed there as well. So lots of opportunities to find courses listed in your area. So I encourage you to find one. It's a wonderful course.
I didn't even know Eventbrite actually did events. I thought it was just parties.
Actually, you can find lots of interesting classes to take as well. So a lot of times when we offer courses, we list them on Eventbrite so that people know they can search for them there and get registered.
Okay, very good.
Yeah.
Well, we have a few minutes left. Is there any topic you'd like that we haven't talked about just yet you'd like to bring up and share with our audience?
Well, I would also like to talk to you about how to become an instructor for mental health first
okay.
aid. If there's somebody out there who is already working in the field and would like to become an instructor, you can search also on the mentalhealthfirstaid.org website, and you can find out how to become an instructor. There
mm-hmm.
is an application process. You have to fill out an application and become approved to become an instructor.
Mm-hmm.
And then you would attend a week-long instructor course.
Okay.
I went with some colleagues from Rochester, New York, where I lived prior.
Okay.
We went out to Las Vegas to a training. There's trainings occurring all over the country. They have a national convention every year.
Oh, okay.
But you take a week-long course and you choose whether or not you want to become certified in the youth course or the adult course.
Okay.
And once you've become certified in one or the other courses, you can then later become certified in the other one. So if you become
okay.
a youth instructor, you can later take a half week long course and become certified as an adult instructor, or vice versa. And then you're required to teach a minimum of 3 courses per year to keep up your certification
okay.
As an instructor. So also, if you become a mental health first aider, if you take the course that I teach, your certification is good for 3 years. So every
okay.
3 years, you would just repeat the course to keep up your certification. Similar to getting the CPR certificate,
mm-hmm.
you have to renew it ever so often just to keep your skills sharp.
And that would certainly make sense.
Absolutely.
So if you want to become certified in youth and adult, it would be a week and a half then. And is there, right? You don't
if
have to take
If you wanted
the
to be an instructor,
instructor
correct.
Instructor, right.
Mm-hmm. Right, like what I do.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And how far in advance would one need to sign up for those courses? I mean,
to be an instructor.
To be an instructor.
Oh, well, the application process is quite lengthy,
okay.
and they have to approve you to become a course instructor. And so I would say that's probably a several month process to become
okay.
approved, and then find a course that you could take, and then make travel arrangements to go to one. I'm not sure that they've offered them in the Nashville area recently, but
okay.
I do know that they've brought them here before. But you know, you would have to travel usually to go to one of those classes.
Okay, so basically one would need to go online and
yes.
just kind of plan ahead
yes,
as to
and
where
research
they would
that.
Need the research, the time to get approved, and
exactly.
then to find a program
exactly.
and travel there.
That's right. But just to take a mental health first aid class and become a mental health
mm-hmm.
first aider, those classes are offered in the Nashville area quite frequently.
Oh,
and
okay.
so
that's
you could
good
just
to know.
Go on and sign up and look for one of those classes, or you know, check out our website, Greater Nashville Mental Health First Aid.
Okay.
Yeah.
Very good. I think we have a couple minutes. Is there anything else we might that we've not talked about that the audience might be interested in knowing around mental health first aid?
Well, let's see. I think that I wanted to mention just decrease in stigma. I wanted to make sure mm-hmm. that we, you know, covered about decrease in stigma. And that, you know, we know that people very often don't seek treatment. Or they might go to their primary care physician and say, you know, my stomach hurts, or I've not been sleeping well, or I've had a lot of headaches. Very often people will go to their primary care physician, and or they might dismiss some of their physical symptoms mm-hmm. because they don't realize they're actually experiencing a mental health problem. Mm-hmm. So hopefully when you go to your primary care physician and he or she rules out the physical problems, mm-hmm. he or she may go on to do a mental health screen and ask you some important questions like, do you cry for no reason that you can't explain? Mm-hmm. Or that do you ever feel guilty about the use of your alcohol or other drugs? Mm-hmm. Do you ever drink first thing in the morning? Mm-hmm. Do you ever use substances to change the way that you feel? Mm. Hopefully your primary care physician, once he or she has ruled out some of the physical problems that mm-hmm. may be causing your stomach to hurt, or for you to have frequent headaches, or for you not to be sleeping as well, or for you to be sleeping too much, he or she will be able to go on and do a mental health screen and then make an appropriate referral from there. So a lot of times people will present with physical symptoms and not realizing that it could be an underlying mental health problem. So if you know of a loved one who's not engaging like he or she once has, that may be an indicator that you can encourage them to go to their primary care physician and then hopefully be able to figure out that it may be more than you think going on. Mm-hmm. So.
There usually is, it seems like, mm-hmm. All around. It's such a comprehensive thing. So, yes, well, thank you so much for being with us today. Before you leave, I did notice, I forgot to mention this on the website, that Lady Gaga has been also involved in this organization
She has definitely been a spokesperson. She has taken the mental health first aid class, and she's very involved. Michelle Obama took the class. Mm-hmm. She was very involved in it as well. We've had a lot of proponents who, you know, really have engaged with the course. I hope that anyone who's watching will take the time to go to the mentalhealthfirstaid.org website and really browse around and check out what's going on. It's a wonderful organization. Mm-hmm. They're doing great things.
Indeed. Well, thank you for being with us today. Thank you for joining us today for another episode of Psychology Matters TV. Visit us on Facebook and YouTube and lend us your comments and thoughts, and we would love to hear from you. Thank you so much and have a wonderful day.